I want to take you on a jet tour through the New Testament today. I've been made very keenly aware the last 3 weeks I've taken on assignments that are probably ones I never want to take on again, to try to give the whole Bible in one sermon, the Old Testament in one, now the New Testament in one sermon. I'm having to give you just some basic highlights, and my desire is this, that through what I'm sharing with you, it would stir up within you a desire to study the Word and read the Word. By the way, in the New Testament, there are 27 books, and of the 27 books, 17 of them can be read in 30 minutes or less. So you can do this. You can make it happen. And I'll be talking about the different books of the Bible. Let me give you a quick understanding of how the New Testament came and compared to the Old Testament. First of all, they are two parts of one package. God is not different in one than he is in the other. The difference is this: in the Old Testament, what was presented to man was the law that calls us to perfection, which we all fall short of. The Old Testament pointed out the fact that we are needy. People in the Old Testament, by the way, they received salvation through faith in Jesus Christ, just like we do, the Messiah, looking forward to his coming. We look back at when he came, and they find faith in Christ, even though it may not always be clearly defined. That was the source of their salvation. Now, put in your notes, if you got it there, and I think these probably made it into the notes on the app, too. I meant to say this last week. There's more than five, but five major sources that I used to compile this information. One is the Fire Bible, the notes that are in it. A second one is a book called What the Bible is All About by Henrietta Mears. The third and fourth one are from a website called Bible.org. And if you can look up the sites that are there. One's called the Old Testament Concise Old Testament Survey. The other's the Concise New Testament Survey. Tremendous resources, probably in total about 70 or 80 pages and about 50 pages between Old and New Testament there. And then I came across one this week that was a New Testament survey that's really good, 4 to 5 pages on most of the books of the New Testament, called JesusAlive.cc New Testament Survey. So take a chance and look those up later. I'm going to take you back to the theme verse for this series. Paul said to Timothy, all Scripture is breathed out by God and profitable for teaching, reproof, correction, for training in righteousness, so that the man of God may be complete, equipped for every good work. Okay, a couple things I want to talk about with the New Testament. The time between the Old Testament and the New Testament was about 400 years. There was very little revelation that occurred during that period. It's often called the Dark Age of God, the time when His will was not revealed fresh and new. They still had the Old Testament, but the new things that God was doing was not seen by the people. And to understand that, what happens, this comes from an article by Merrill C. Tinney in his book called New Testament Times. Listen to this, because it's a tremendous understanding of what life was like. Paganism and all religions, apart from knowledge and faith in God's Word, always produce a parody and a perversion of God's original revelation to man. In other words, when we do not have knowledge and faith in God, the result of that is something that is woefully weak, that may have the appearance of truth, but not the reality. When there is no faith, we cannot please God. Here's how he goes on to describe it. It retains many basic elements of truth, but twists them into practical falsehood. Divine sovereignty becomes fatalism. Grace becomes indulgence. Righteousness becomes conformity to arbitrary rules. Worship becomes empty ritual. Prayer becomes selfish begging. The supernatural degenerates into superstition. The light of God is clouded by fanciful legend and downright falsehood. The consequent confusion of beliefs and of values left man wandering in a maze of uncertainties. I'm reading this because it sounds like the age in which we live. Listen as I go on with his comments here. To some, expediency becomes the dominant philosophy of life. In other words, do it now, do it fast, seize the day. For if there can be no ultimate certainty, there can be no permanent principles by which we guide conduct. And if there are no permanent principles, one must live as well as he can by the advantage of the moment. Skepticism prevailed, for the old gods had lost their power and no new gods had appeared. Numerous novel cults invaded the empire from every quarter and became the fad of delineation, rich of the refuse of the desperate poor. Men had largely lost the sense of joy and destiny that made human life worthwhile. Then Jesus showed up in the midst of all of that. Now, let me give you a quick thought on how the New Testament came into being. One more thing I want to read to you from Charles Ryrie just real quick, and then I'll get away from the reading. But these are important paragraphs to hear. He talks about how the canon came into being, and canon means the authorized books of Scripture. He says, after they were written, the individual books were not immediately gathered together into the canon or collection of 27 that comprised the New Testament. Groups of books like Paul's letters and the gospel were preserved at first by the church or people to whom they were sent. And gradually, all 27 books were collected and formally acknowledged by the church as a whole. This process took about 350 years. By the way, the New Testament only took 50 years to write, but 350 years to approve it as the Word of God. In the second century, the circulation of books that promoted heresy accumulated or accentuated the need for distinguishing valid scriptures from other literature. Certain tests were developed to determine what should be included. Was the book written or approved by an apostle? Were its contents of a spiritual nature? Did it give evidence of being inspired by God? Was it widely received by the churches? Those are the four things they looked at to determine which books should be put in the Bible. Not all the 27 books received immediate reception, being accepted by the church. This does not mean that they were not appropriate or were not good, but it simply meant that they were careful in the process. Letters addressed to individuals would not have been circulated as widely as those sent to the church. And then in the Council of Carthage in AD 397, they were brought together and put into the order that we have now as the New Testament. There are no copies of any of the writings that comprise the New Testament in its original form that have survived, but there are more than 4,500 Greek manuscripts of all or part of the text, plus 8,000 Latin manuscripts, and at least 1,000 other versions with the original books were translated, carefully studied and compared these copies to give us the New Testament today. So that's a little bit of the background on how the New Testament works. The Bible has two divisions, the Old Testament and the New Testament, four sections in each. In the New Testament, the first section is called the Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. I'll explain in a minute why there are four instead of just one. They have different points of focus and understanding. The Gospels tell about the manifestation of Christ. They describe the fact that Jesus came from heaven to earth. They tell about what he did as he walked on the planet, how he lived, how he died, how he was resurrected. These things are common in all four of the Gospels. The next book is the book of Acts. It's the book of history of the early church. It describes the development and the advancement of the church of Jesus Christ. The third category are the letters or epistles, which is a word that means letters that were written. There are 21 of those books. They are all the way from Romans up through 3 John. They provide explanation and application of the gospel. These all interconnect. And the last category is one book, the book of prophecy, the book of Revelation. It provides encouragement for believers regarding the consummation, the fulfillment, the finalization of the gospel. The purpose of the New Testament is to reveal the Savior who's come to bring freedom from sin. So let's go into the gospels real quick. Now, I know there are 27. And the tendency, I would be incredibly rushed, just to make it real plain for you, if I took 5 minutes on each one. But if I did that, we would be here for a couple hours. I'm not doing that. I'm going to be even quicker than that today, and I'm encouraging you to go back and read it on your own, study it on your own. If you'd like to talk with me about it, give me a call, come by and have a cup of coffee, go to lunch, go to breakfast, and I'll be glad to dialogue with you as much as you want to on the Gospels. One of the foundation verses for the entire Gospels, I think, comes in Galatians chapter 4, verse 4. It's not in your notes, but the Bible says, when the fullness of time had come, God sent His Son. That is the story of what the gospel of Jesus Christ is all about. So there are four gospels. What is the purpose? Well, the first three are called the synoptic gospels. Now, let me tell you what that big fancy word means. How many of you ever have read a synopsis? It means to bring it down into a tangible, viewable place. And so the word synoptic, the prefix syn means together, synthesized, to bring things together. The word optic, we all know that word, right? Anybody been to the optician lately? A guy who looks at your eyes and tells you what's going on. The ability to see things that are blended together with a similar point of view. Matthew, Mark, and Luke have that. John is a little bit different, and I'll explain that in a minute. Matthew addresses his gospel primarily to the Jews. He is writing to let the Jewish people know Messiah has come. He describes Jesus as the King of the Jews. The emphasis in Matthew, 28 chapters, has 12 Old Testament prophecies mentioned and described. 9 times you read this phrase that's not in any other gospel, that it might be fulfilled. He's writing to people who understood the prophecies of the Old Testament, and he's telling them that all of the things that the prophets wrote about, all the history of the Old Testament points to Jesus Christ, who has now come as the Messiah, the King of the Jews, to bring us freedom. When you look through the book, you see there are key verses in chapter 1, verses 20 through 23 that speak of the virgin birth. In chapter 5, verses 13 through 15, we're called to be salt and light, and our character it's informed to us that our character must be beyond reproof. In chapter 6, 25 through 34, we read about the reality that we are to seek first the kingdom of God and His righteousness. We read all of these things. The Great Commission, the Great Commandment comes in Matthew 22, 34 through 40. They tried to trick Jesus and they said, what is the greatest commandment of them all? And Jesus said, very simple, love God. That's number one, love God. Let me tell you something this morning. It's important you study the Word of God, that you grow in your understanding. But if you can grasp the reality of this, the number one assignment of your life is to love God. Not only in theory, not only with mental assent, but love God with your heart. That's where your affection is, with the mind, the things you think about, with your body, with your strength, everything that you have, everything that you are. Focus on loving God with who you are. He goes on to say, you only asked me about one, but I'll give you two. The second greatest commandment is this: love your neighbor as yourself. Isn't it amazing that Jesus said those two things right there are the foundation for every other law, and if you do those two things, you will fulfill the rest of them by doing that. You will eliminate selfishness. If you're loving others and you're preferring them, then in Matthew 28, 18 through 20 gives the Great Commission, which means we're supposed to be going about advancing God's kingdom. The phrase kingdom of heaven is mentioned 32 times in Matthew, nowhere else. The Sermon on the Mount comes to us in chapters 5 through 7. The book of Mark, a little different than Matthew. Matthew's addressing the Jews. Mark addresses primarily the Romans. He presents Jesus as the suffering saint. One of the key words in there, depending on what version you have, it may be straightway if you're a King James guy, but newer versions use the word immediately. And it speaks about the fact that Jesus, Mark records it this way, is he was a man of action. That that appealed to the understanding of the Roman people, that he was a man who acted in a way that was efficient and effective. The emphasis in Mark is on miracles. Two key verses in chapter 8, Jesus tells us that if you want to follow me, take up your cross and come follow me. Then you read over in chapter 10, I preached about it a few weeks ago. Jesus said the key to leadership in the body of Christ is not gaining authority, but it's becoming a servant. And if you want to become great, you must become the slave of all. The book of Luke was addressed primarily to the Greeks, explaining Jewish terms and customs to make the gospel understandable for the Greek population. He strongly presents the true humanity of Jesus as the Son of Man, while also declaring his deity. Special emphasis in Luke has to deal with prayer. 32 times it's talked about. 17 times Luke mentions women, their story, what's going on in their life. He talks about them. Luke is the doctor. He's also the only Gentile to write any of the New Testament. He speaks of healing, part of his connection by being a doctor. Funny little observation for you. When Mark talks about the lady with the issue of blood, here's how Mark describes it. Mark, by the way, I didn't say this a while ago. Let me back up and give you this. Mark was not one of the original people to be there when Christ was around and following him, but he was a disciple of Peter and also an associate of Paul, and he was taught these things through them. And so Mark primarily is the writing or the words of Peter written down by Mark. So Mark writes this, and there's two or three other funny things like this, how different authors put it a different way. When Mark is talking about the lady with the issue of blood, here's what he said. She had suffered at the hands of doctors. Now, Luke did not find that particularly flattering by being a doctor. When Luke records this story, he said she had an incurable disease. There's another spot like that where one of the writers of Scripture who was a fisherman, when he's talking about the storm, one of the storms that came up when they were out in the boat, he said, the fisherman said, it was a small little squall. It was just a little storm, no big deal. One of the other gospel writers who was more comfortable on land than on water, he said it was a storm like an earthquake had hit right there in the lake. So you get these pictures of their personality coming through. They're not in contradiction with each other. They're just different ways to describe the same thing. Let me explain it to you, how that would work for us. So how many diehard, sooner born, sooner bred kind of OU fans are in the room? Hand real high in the air. If you are one, you will not be ashamed. It'll go up quickly. Okay, put your hands down. How many Cowboys are in the room that just, you bleed orange? Okay, which is really weird, by the way. I don't know. You may need to see a doctor about that. Several hands go up. Okay, do you understand that if a diehard Sooner fan and a diehard Cowboy fan are talking about the same game, and they're both giving factual information, it may include different details? I'm not accusing either one of them of lying. They can be telling the truth as they see it and understand it. But whichever team wins will probably say something like, it was a great game. The officials did a phenomenal job. And whoever loses is going to say, the field was in poor condition. The officials were probably recruited last minute, and they from the Blind Academy, I think. I don't know where they came from. You understand what I'm saying? You're telling the same story, but from different perspectives. There's nothing that contradicts in the different Gospels. They just come from different places. Luke is to the Greek. He talks about the Son of Man and talks about Jesus as a person. We read probably the most about the birth of Jesus in Luke's gospel more than the others. That may be part of the doctor thing coming again through again. John is not like the others. John has different material, It is written to Christians regarding the deity of Jesus. So Matthew presents him as the King of the Jews. Mark shows him as the suffering servant. Luke shows him as the Son of Man. And John shows him as the Son of God. Regarding the deity of Jesus, he's declared to be God's Son. Some key words in here, the word Father, 122 times, speaking of God the Father in John. The other three books combined is only about 80. This was a concept that John picked up on, and he realized God the Father and made a big connection there. 96 times the word believe, the world 80 times, light 20 times, love 56 times, witness 22 times. And in John, you read about seven I am statements of who Jesus is, which the thing that's important about that word, the name for God is I am that I am. And so when Jesus says I am seven times and gives different seven pictures, it's an awareness of the fact the deity of Jesus being expressed. Not only that, but there are seven miraculous signs that come there that give stories and testimony of who Jesus is. And there's actually an eighth miracle that happens after he dies when he is resurrected. So that's the eighth miracle, seven that he performed. And actually, he was raised up by the power of the Holy Spirit, and that was the eighth miracle. Interestingly enough, in the book of John, there are zero parables. That wasn't the focus of John. He was talking about some other things, so that's why it's there. Then we go to the book of Acts, the early church history. Acts is written by Luke. Luke's writings of the book of Luke and the book of Acts make up 28% of the New Testament by volume. Two books, but they're both huge. By contrast, Paul has about 30% of the New Testament. So Luke is right there with him in the words that he writes. Acts is the history, and I have it his story, if you look at it there, of what the Holy Spirit began to do in the church. 52 times, listen to this, this is a great thought for us today. 52 times we read about the growth of the church by the power of the Holy Spirit. The book of Acts is all about how the church grew by the power of the Holy Spirit. And I want to make a very strong, clear statement for you here today. There are a lot of things that we do to encourage people to come, and there are events that we have and guests that we bring in. And all of those things are, they have their place, and there's nothing wrong with them. But the foundation upon which any church grows is the power of the Holy Spirit at work among the people. That is the key to churches growing. Now, that should make you feel pretty good about life. I personally think that when we're done, we already have a great facility, and we're going to have a phenomenal facility when we're done. But we're not building that thing to go, wow, look at our building. We're not taking pride in who our staff is and how gifted they are or how wonderful our congregation is. We're a loving, caring church. Those things are all good. They have their place. But listen to me. The number one thing that we must grab hold of, if we're going to see the church grow, it will happen by the power of the Holy Spirit at work in your life and in my life, and people will come and be drawn in because of that. So many great key verses here, 1:8 about receiving power, 2:4 about the day of Pentecost, 42 and 47 through 47 of chapter 2 speaks of the early church and how it functioned. And going on down, there's many, many great verses there. Special emphasis in the book of Acts is on prayer. It is a major focal point of what happened in the book of Acts. They prayed is a continual theme of the book. The value of women is clearly positioned in the book of Acts. You know, I listen to things from my childhood that impact me strongly, and I think of the great sermon, the great speech that was given by Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. when he talked about having a dream. And part of the dream that he had was this, that one day people will be, they will be valued, they will be looked at based on the character and the conduct that they display more than the color of their skin or more than anything else. Paul speaks of this quite frequently. And I encourage you to receive this freedom in your life today. I know it's the heart of your pastor and the heart of this church. God uses men. God uses women. God uses people of all races. He uses people of all socioeconomic standards. He blesses the poor. He blesses the rich. God wants to use all of us. Every one of you in this room, you are commissioned by God to do the work of the ministry. And it's sad that we continue to build little camps that fight against one another. One of the major pushes right now, and I hope I communicate this clearly, and I hope you understand me well. One of the major things that's going on today in the Democratic Party in particular is a push to present a female as candidate for president of the United States. Listen to me. I will vote for a lady. I will vote for a man. I'll vote for somebody if they're brown, green, purple, or polka dotted, if they can do the job. But I'm not going to vote for someone based on that being the reason, because they fit into some demographic. Let us be people of wisdom who embrace every person as being the creation of God, who has value and purpose. Men, women, white, black, Native American, whatever category you want to put on there. And what we see in the book of Acts is God used everybody. I've said this before about our church and just repeat it for you. We do not have a lot of titles, but we have a lot of work. And if you're looking for a title, you're probably at the wrong church. But if you want to work, welcome. There's a city that needs Jesus. There are neighbors on your street that need Jesus. There are missionaries around the world who need to be equipped to do their work, and we're going to do it. I got a note. I don't always tell you these stories. I got a note the other day from a missionary. I may have told this recently to some of you anyway. I got a note from a missionary, and he said that they had a problem with the house they were in. They had built some things around it, and people were up late at night, and they couldn't sleep, and they were going to have to get a different house somewhere, and they got to raise some more money, and he's asking for 20 churches to help, and would we be one of them? And within 3 minutes, I responded back, "Put us down. We are one. We'll help you get what you need to do the work you're supposed to do." Those things happen on a regular basis because of your faithfulness in giving to our missions fund. There's a focus on the prayer on women, on the Old Testament. The key people, Peter's the main person in chapters 1 through 12. Then Paul comes on the scene in chapter 13 through 28. And the key event of the book of Acts in the last part are the missionary journeys, taking the gospel to the world. So that's the history of the church. The next one are the letters, the epistles, and there's three different categories. The first one is Paul's letters to the church. They're not in the order in which they were written here. And I think I've got in your notes there what the order basically is how this plays out. Romans was the sixth letter that he wrote, probably. You say, how come we can't be more specific and more sure about some of these kind of things? Because it wasn't an issue when they wrote it, so they didn't date it. They didn't put that, so we have to try to figure it out. When I say we, I should say they have to try to figure it out, and I read what they write. Scholars look at it and they determine what they think to be the time of writing. And sometimes there's clear indication by something that's left out or something that's included. Romans is the sixth letter that Paul wrote. It's the first one that comes after Acts because of its scope and importance. It is the most complete presentation of what salvation through faith in Jesus Christ is all about. The doctrine is clearly explained. We find in it what's called the Romans Road. If anybody ever went through that, how we help people come to know Christ, taking them to Romans 3 and say all have sinned, then Romans chapter 6 and telling them that God has given a gift of eternal life through Jesus Christ. And over to Romans chapter 10 that talks about the fact that if we'll believe in our heart that God raised Jesus from the dead and confess with our mouth Jesus Lord, we shall be saved. Romans gives us all of those great verses. It's one of my favorite books. You'll hear me say that a lot in these few books right here. The key thought is the righteousness of God. Key verses is 1:16 and 17 about the power of God for salvation through the gospel. 5:1 says we have peace with God. And you read down through the rest of them. The key chapter is chapter 8. If you want to read a chapter that will just get you feeling good about life, Romans 8 is it. We are free from the law of sin, and we have the Spirit of God. We walk in grace and in goodness. And by the way, grace does not lead us towards sin. Grace leads us away from sin. Grace does not give us permission to go do all these wild things and say, well, he's okay with it. No, grace empowers me to say no to sin, to live godly and righteous because of the power of the Holy Spirit that's in me, that's in you. Romans says that through him we have freedom. 1 Corinthians, probably the fourth letter. It's the second largest in volume. Romans is first. The purpose of this letter is to address problems in the church. I started to go here and read off the list of all the problems that they had. Let me just tell you, Corinth was messed up. They were gifted. This is a horrible combination, too. They were gifted, but they were immature. So it's like they could do some stuff, and they could razzle-dazzle you, and they had speakers, and they had things going on, but they were doing some dumb stuff. They were involved in sexual activity that was totally inappropriate, and nobody would address it, and just kind of went on and whatever. And so Paul writes this letter, and he speaks to them about the need for correction in what they're doing. They also thought they were incredibly brilliant. It's one thing to be arrogant. It gets worse when you are ignorant and arrogant. You think you know everything, but you don't know anything. And so that's the church at Corinth. And Paul writes some things that are very critical in chapter 12 through 14. He writes the church at Corinth about the fact that they are one body. And he goes through this ridiculous illustration there. He says, so if the whole body were an eye, where would the sense of hearing be? Now, picture what he's saying there in a physical deal. So what if they roll me up here today and I'm a big old giant eyeball? It would get pretty boring pretty quick, but I wouldn't miss a thing. I would see every one of you because, after all, I'm the eyeball. But he goes on to talk about the fact that we are all part of the body of Christ. We fit together. One can't say to the other, I don't need you. But we work in cooperation. What a beautiful picture of the unity that God wants the church to have. He talks about wisdom. He talks about weakness and gives key chapters 12 through 14. 2 Corinthians is the fifth of his letters, written shortly after 1 Corinthians, probably about 6 months or so. How many of you know when you write the correction letter and it doesn't work, you write a second correction letter? That would be 2 Corinthians. So about 6 months later, he writes back again, and it gets a little stronger, a little more clear. In this letter, he tells them about his role. Some people have said, well, who is he anyway? After all, he's kind of ugly and he's not a good speaker. That's what they said. And Paul said, well, let me tell you what my credentials are. I've been beaten and left for dead because of the cause of Jesus Christ. I've been shipwrecked. I've had people throw rocks at me. I've had people take rods and beat me. I've been hungry. I've been out and abandoned. And in all of these things, I've pressed on because I am a servant of the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, what have you done? It kind of silenced the critics just a little bit. This word tells us that Paul is an apostle because he is called by God. Interestingly enough, one of the key words in this chapter is the word comforts there 14 times. You see 14x, the x means times, by the way. That's a lot in the notes overall. Boasts is 13 times, light 9, 6 times, affliction 3 times, churches 8 times, key chapters are 8 and 9. Galatians, first letter that he ever wrote, very similar to Romans and Corinthians, heavily influenced the Reformation. Galatians was the book that caused Martin Luther to kind of recognize there need to be some changes in the church world. Galatians and Romans in particular, those two came together. It has been called the Magna Carta of the Christian liberty. Key verses are 2, 20 and 21, 5, 1 and 13, 6. And it tells us, Galatians tells us about the difference between walking in the flesh and walking in the spirit. It is a great, great book. It's my favorite book. Ephesians chapter 4. Just seeing if you're listening and paying attention there. This is the first of the called prison letters because Paul wrote them when he was in prison. Ephesians may be the crown jewel of the New Testament. The beauty of its writing is just inexpressible. There are six chapters. The first three talk about doctrinal issues, who we are in Christ. The last three last three chapters, 4, 5, and 6, talk about how we practically live that out. So it's a beautiful combination of what we believe and what we do. Our creed and our conduct come together. I did a series on Ephesians not too awful long ago, and it is just a great, great, great book. I put for key verses most of them, okay? So that's, I can't get much more specific than that. Key words, in Christ is there 10 times. Love is there 13 times. Grace is there 12 times. Philippians is another prison letter. It's the fourth of four. It's the 10th letter overall written. And probably before I even looked at this, I've read Philippians many times. It is a great book. It's an upbeat, positive book. And I had kind of a new awareness as I was reading through some of the notes and whatever. I went back and I went, that's absolutely right. When I think about Philippians, my original thought would have been the major theme of Philippians is joy. And that is an accurate statement. But there's one word that's in there much more than joy, and it's the word Christ. If we're not careful, we pursue the product rather than the one who causes the product. The Christian life is not primarily designed to find joy and grace and peace and goodness. The Christian life is designed to know God in His fullness, to make Jesus Christ your Lord, to be filled with the Holy Spirit every day. And when you do those things, it will produce joy and peace and grace in your life. But if we're pursuing joy as our primary function of life, we have the strong potential of getting messed up. Paul says, because of Jesus Christ, your life should be filled with joy. Christ is in that short little book, four chapters, about 100 verses, 37 times the word Christ is there. The word joy is there 16 times. And one of the key thoughts of the book is unity or oneness. And there's some great key verses you can look at later. Colossians is another prison letter. It's the second of four. It's the eighth letter. It talks about the supremacy of Christ. And in this book, Paul confronts the false teachers of Gnosticism. Now, you may not know what Gnosticism is, so let me give you just a very quick definition, overview of it. Gnosticism was this... When people start developing human philosophy about the gospel, you get in trouble. Through the years, I've been in a lot of Sunday school classes where the major focus of conversation was, well, what do you think that means? I don't know. What do you think it means? And I'm going, oh, Jesus, help us. Here's what I think. Well, I don't mean this wrong, but can I just say it as bluntly as I know how? I really don't care what you think. And you really shouldn't care what I think. That's not the major focus of the way we approach knowing Jesus. It's what does it mean? You got to do a little bit of work there. Not a lot, but a little. You got to understand context. And if you don't understand it, there are books that can help you. There, talk to me. Talk to some other folks. We'll help you understand the context of what is there. But we too often go, well, you know, I was just thinking about this, and here's kind of what I came up with. Oh, boy, we're going to get in trouble now. Gnosticism was trying to figure out how Jesus is both fully God and fully man, and they couldn't get their head wrapped around it. Hey, congratulations, neither can I. He wasn't 50% God, 50% man. I don't understand it, okay, but the gospel is all based in the supernatural. You got to believe that first of all. You go, well, hold on, I just don't know if I can buy some of that. Okay, If you if you're a Christian, you believe the Word of God, you believe that God spoke, creation came into existence, that was pretty supernatural. Fast forward, there's a lot of supernatural stories in the Old Testament. Fast forward to the birth of Christ. He was born of a virgin, a woman who had never been involved sexually with the man, but somehow she becomes pregnant. Now, I know a lot of people have claimed that, but it was true with her. It was true. It's like, wow. Then he died and rose from the dead. Do you understand? The whole thing is built on the supernatural. Not the superstitious, the supernatural. When we come to that point of understanding this Gnosticism mindset, so here's reality. Jesus was 100% God and 100% man. We'll say, how can he be 200%? I don't know. When I get to heaven, we'll figure it out and we'll talk about it. Probably won't care at that point, but... So the Gnostics said, well, here's the deal. The spirit is pure and good, but the body, the material, is evil. And therefore, Jesus really was never, he was just kind of a floating appearance of a man, but never really was a man. Okay, we have just discredited the gospel. Now, it went further to say this. So, when my body does things that are wrong, it's really not that big a deal because the body's evil anyway, but my spirit sure is good. Here's how we would say that today. Well, he does a lot of bad things, but he sure has a good heart. Okay, if your heart's right, your actions are going to line up with it. I know that we all have things of decision that we don't always get right. And sometimes we can mess up with our head that we don't think clearly. And a lot of times I'm making decisions where there's four options. I don't like any of them. I get that. I don't know. Let me give you an example. I told our staff the other day when we had the snow came and or the ice was coming and Reggie was here. And we're talking about, do we have service on that Wednesday night for our youth or not? And I'm talking with Pastor Kevin. We're going back and forth, and we decided to go ahead and do it. He's going to be here Sunday, but let's do it Wednesday night anyway because God's going to do something great. And that night, Pastor Kevin, 24 kids gave their heart to Jesus. And we're able, after the event, to go, we got that right. But you realize how easily that could have changed? So all night long, till it's over, I'm praying, oh, God, keep everybody safe. Oh, God, don't let roads get slick. Please, Lord, please, please, please. But it could have. And so at that point, if it had something happen that was of a negative nature, we would have looked and said, we got it wrong. We may not always get it right or wrong with our head, because you can't always, you cannot, sometimes choices are tough. But our heart has to be pure. We can't make a mistake with our heart. This letter speaks of the fact in Colossians that Jesus Christ is supreme. Great verses in 1:15 through 23 speak of the supremacy of God. Chapter 3 is a beautiful chapter about get rid of the old clothing that you're wearing that's tainted by sin and put on the right clothing of being a follower of Jesus Christ. Chapter 4 talks about always be ready to give the right word. 1 Thessalonians is the second letter that Paul wrote after Galatians. It's encouragement for young believers to live in sanctification. One of the lies the devil's been given for years is that sanctification is this hard, awful, horrible thing, and that we overcome it by just indulging in the goodness of life sometimes. That being a Christian means you can't do anything and you have to give up everything. Paul says, live a sanctified life and it will produce joy in your life, goodness in your life. How many of you know that when you live a sanctified life, you don't have to worry about people finding out what you did? You don't have to worry about, I don't remember what happened last night, I hope everything's okay. I may or may not get through the rest of them. Let me park here for just 1 minute. The lie of the devil is always this. It's the lie of rationalization. It's a lie that says, well, that's really not that big a deal. After all, What about in this case? What about in this scenario? And how far is too far? And, you know, and just keep inching over a little bit further. The Bible says to stay away from evil things and to pursue godliness and righteousness. I don't know where everybody in the room is on this topic, and I'm not trying to make you mad. If I do, well, know my heart's good, okay? It's amazing to me how last year as a state, and don't amen me a whole lot right now, that's not my point in sharing this, is that I get a lot of affirmation. I'm just making a point right now. That last year when our state was considering the legalization of medical marijuana, it was always talked about this will help small children who have seizures and older adults who have diseases that have continual pain and give them some relief. And yet I watched that night on TV at the watch parties. I didn't see one epileptic child there. I didn't see one elderly person suffering from cancer or some other disease that said, yes, this is going to help me and benefit me. Now, if the medical community comes out and says there are some benefits and there are some good parts of that, then I'll listen to what they have to say, but none of that's been said yet. It's the theory of rationalization. You know as well as I do, if you watched any of the watch parties or any of the things that came out after that, the entire goal of that law being pushed forward, that bill being pushed forward, is so that somewhere in the near future, there will be a campaign for what they said was not even on the table, which is the recreational usage of marijuana. That is the nature of sin. And Paul says to the people at Thessalonica, we are to pursue righteousness and to be sanctified. And he says the motivation for it is the fact that Jesus is coming back. The return of Jesus Christ is mentioned in every chapter of 1 Thessalonians. Now some would say, well, he got it wrong. No, he just was able to see way into the future. And if it were true back then, how much more true is it today? Let me kick on through these real quick. We'll see where we get to. 2 Thessalonians, his third letter, written months after 1 Thessalonians, again, back pretty quick, shortest of the church letters. These first group of epistles are called the church letters. The key word is disorderly, used three times nowhere else in the New Testament. Key thoughts are perseverance and readiness. Then we come to what are called the pastoral epistles. These are written to encourage individuals in the duties of the church. 1 Timothy, 11th letter. Letter of instruction and encouragement regarding church operations. Key words are godliness and doctrine. Faith is there 19 times. Good's there 23 times. And some great key verses to read. 2 Timothy is the 13th and the last of his letters. 3 to 5 years after 1 Timothy. It makes me feel better about Timothy. He didn't get a second letter 3 weeks or 3 months later. 3 to 5 years later. It's near Paul's death. He gives instruction and encouragement for Timothy and the church. Some great key verses there. Titus is the 12th book, another one of the pastoral letters. Doing good works is mentioned 9 times. Some people grab a truth and then they create a position that's in error because they misunderstand the truth. Here is the truth. No one is ever saved by their good works. We are saved by the grace of God. That's true. But let me go on. Because we are saved by the grace of God, we are compelled to do good works. And good works are not the cause of salvation, but they are the proof of salvation. We have to be people who go about doing good works. After all, wasn't it said of Jesus Christ, he went about doing good. Are we followers of Jesus? If we are, we will go about doing good. Titus was the pastor at Crete, a city that's filled with wicked people. It's said about them that they are liars, they are gluttons, and they're lazy. And one of their own made that comment, by the way, is what Paul says. And yet, Titus is told to go there and to help be a pastor. He also gives some good insight. Let me read this one quote to you. It's in your notes there. Even good deeds are not to be the product of human ingenuity or dead religion, but the work of God's grace through faith in the power of God as manifested in Christ the Savior. The book of Philemon's a little short book. It's the third of the prison letters. It's the fourth of the sequence here. It's a letter of reconciliation and forgiveness to Philemon about Onesimus. And he says to him, this guy was your slave. He stole some stuff and ran away. But now he's accepted Jesus as his Savior. So Philemon, since I am the one who helped you come to know Christ as Savior, I'm asking you to be gracious to him. I mean, this is what's called putting the squeeze on somebody. Paul says, I'm not going to ask you to repay me for all that I've done for you. I could, but I'm not going to, but I am going to ask you to be gracious and forgiving. It's a beautiful picture also of how God the Father extends love and grace to us also. Hebrews, the unknown author, theme surpassing greatness of Christ, keywords better, perfect, heavenly. Key chapters 1 and 11 and some great verses there for you. James, first book written in the New Testament. Some people did not like James at the start. Some people don't like it today, probably. James was the half-brother of Jesus. Mary was his mother. Joseph was his father. The key word is faith. 16 times, works 13 times. Key chapters are 1 and 4. And great things there. First Peter, the key theme is perseverance through persecution. Key word suffer 15 times, hope 4 times. The key chapter is 4 and some key verses. I hope y'all read those in the next few days or the next couple of weeks. 2 Peter, written to Christians scattered abroad to expose false teachers. Key verses are listed there for you. 1 John, key verses are listed. And God is mentioned 60 times in 42 verses. It's pretty amazing. One of the key words of 1 John is the word love. He says, if you don't love your brother, then you probably don't love God. And if you say you love God, but you don't love your brother, you are a liar. I would have gotten in trouble when I was a young man, when I was a child, for using that word liar. But John says it's the right word and the right phrase. It also gives a certainty of salvation in 5:13. 2 John 13 verses, key word is truth. 5 times in the first 4 verses. 3 John, again, keywords truth 6 times in 5 verses, 13 verses long. Jude, key verses 3, 18 through 24, key thoughts, warning against false teachers, encouraging believers to build themselves up in the faith. Keyword ungodly used 6 times. That's more than any other book of the New Testament. The book of prophecies, the last one, Revelation, keyword unveiling or revelation to make aware, to expose. It is the fulfillment and the culmination of the gospel. It's the establishment of heaven. By the way, when you read through Revelation, there's a lot of scary things in there. There are beasts and wild stuff and bowls of junk getting poured out. It's crazy. Here's what you got to know, though. When all the dust settles and when the air clears, we win. And we have victory all the way through. We win. Revelation is not the revelation of the end times. It's not the revelation of bad things yet to happen. Revelation, here's what the book is. It is the revelation of Jesus Christ. And one day, he will properly be seen and known and proclaimed as King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Paul said in Philippians, at that moment, every knee will bow, every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Well, you kind of came to a smorgasbord today, so I hope you found something you liked in there along the way. Something encourages, something that piqued your interest and your desire to learn and grow more. I want to do a couple things as we conclude. Number one, if you're not a follower of Jesus Christ, today is a great day to say, Lord, I want to give you my life. I want to follow you. I want to serve you. And the Bible says that when we come to him, he would never push us away, but he will welcome us with open arms. He will help us. He will encourage us. He will sustain us. If you need that in your life today, in just a minute, I'm going to pray, and I invite you to join me in that prayer and accept Jesus into your heart. Receive him as your Savior. Second thing I want to do today, I'm going to go back to the book of Acts just real quick with this wrap-up thought. I want to ask how many of you will join me today as we begin to move toward a new building here in just a few weeks. And you'll say right now, I'm going to commit myself to pray every day for my life, because that's where it starts. In the Old Testament, God dwelt in the buildings. But in the New Testament, He dwells in the people. How does God's presence fill the church building? It's when the people of God come together. And so how many of you today will join me in a commitment to pray that the Holy Spirit would fill us individually and our church corporately, and that the Holy Spirit would do things that cause us to grow?